Hello, good evening, and welcome to Biz First in Focus. Our guest this evening is the former Deputy Governor of the Central Bank, a career central banker, former Deputy Governor, and he is a learner, a writer, a lecturer, researcher, and columnist. Currently, he functions as the president of a higher learning institute, and he's with us this evening. He's none other than the one and the only Dr. W.A. Vijayawardene. Very good evening and welcome.
Very good evening, Faraz.
A career central banker. You've retired not too long ago.
I retired in 2009, Faraz.
So that's quite some while ago.
Yeah, about 8 years ago.
Right, but I want to ask you, how sad are you with the turn of events at Central
Bank? Well, of
Bank?
Course, not only me, Faraz, anyone else, the people who are presently working in the Central Bank and those who have retired from the Central Bank, the people who had made their career in the Central Bank, and all of them are very sad about Central Bank today.
And that is because of what? Is it because...
No, I mean, the events that had taken place in the Central Bank during the last 2 year period, specifically the bond scandal, which had eroded the credibility and the reputation of the Central Bank beyond repair. And also because of the new evidence that is surfacing before the Presidential Commission on Bond Scam, the things that are happening in the Central Bank is like a can of worms. And when you open it up more and more, the more worms are now coming out for us, and as a result, people are very sad, they are angry, and as a result, including me, we have been raising our voice against that.
So this departure of from procedure, departure from established procedure, and the actions of the governor inconsistent with the norms that have been and the traditions of the Central Bank has sort of impinged on the overall outlook that people have of the Central Bank.
Exactly. I mean, not only, I mean, you have to look at a Central Bank for us not as an institution serving only the people of the country concerned. A Central Bank is a representation of that country to the outside world, because people outside Sri Lanka, for example, they do not care much about the government in power when it comes to financial matters. The reason is in every country we have established a Central Bank as an independent institution in order to give assurance to people outside the country that they can trust the financial matters in that particular country. And therefore, a central bank's job is to maintain that credibility throughout. And if it is lost, it's very difficult for a central bank to regain it.
Dr. Vijayawardene, you know, with the world is a much smaller place now. You can communicate with across the world from one side to the other in nanoseconds. And information is available at the fingertips of anyone. Of most people all over the world. In that context, you know, would-be investors coming into Sri Lanka couldn't possibly but notice that the governor of the central bank and the central bank was engulfed in an almighty row on the issuance of bonds. And from an outsider's point of view, they're arguing about perhaps very little money from an outsider's point of view. But the procedure that they're arguing about seems to be almost taken for granted in the West, but not so here.
The reason for us is that anyone who is interested in investing in Sri Lanka, they make inquiries about the country. And one of the important institutions about they look at is the central bank of the country. So in that respect, if anybody wants to invest in Sri Lanka, they look at the things that are happening in the central bank, the procedures in the central bank, the governance of the governing board of the central bank, and if they are not happy about it, they will just keep that country out of their horizons. So the things that had happened in the central bank during the last 2 year period, which had not been actually properly addressed by the government in power, has been a negative mark for Sri Lanka when it comes to inviting foreigners to invest in Sri Lanka. We may be getting foreigners far, but they are not of the investors of worth. The type of investors who might come to Sri Lanka, who might want to invest in the real estate sector of the country so that they can quickly make their money and then go out, but not the people who are willing to transfer technology to this country, which is a must today if we want to have a sustainable economic growth.
We find a dearth of let's call them high value projects, promising all sorts of good that will accrue to the country, but on close examination by the media and obviously other interested parties as well, obviously, one finds that these are very surprising, if not questionable, proposed purported investments. And I'm talking about items like the Volkswagen factory, then the world's some tallest building or other. Then we have, you know, the bond matter, and we have government departure from the established rules and procedure in the awarding of tenders for whatever it is, roads, arms and ammunition, whatever. And when you see all this, how does one begin to correct this thing, to say to the outside world, listen guys, Sri Lanka is a land of opportunity where you can make high returns, and these matters that you may have seen negativity about in the press and in social media and on the internet and so on, that these are mere glitches which we are addressing. How does one begin to convince these people?
It should have been done for us right at the beginning when the new government came to power. They could have made foreign investment policy statement, which should be followed to the letter by the institutions involved, because there are a large number of institutions involved for us, the Central Bank, the Board of Investment, the Ministry of Finance, the Ministry of Economic Development, the Ministry of Economic Affairs, and all these institutions which are involved and which have a responsibility for the economic development of the country. They have to tune their policies towards a single objective, and that would help the country to convince the foreign investors that they should come here, because the most important factor today we are facing for us is the policy reversal. Anyone who wants to commit his money for a long period in this country or any other country, he would love to have a policy consistency package. And even when the policies are taken today and tomorrow, when you reverse them, then there is an uncertainty, and the investors don't like that kind of an uncertainty from a foreign country. In fact, if it is from a market for us, they have various methods of mitigating the uncertainty by going into insurance and so forth. But when it comes to a country where the uncertainty comes from the policy reversal, they don't like it, and as a result, they just shun away from that country. And in order to avoid that, as you had very correctly asked me, the first thing would have been to issue an investment policy statement, which would give guidelines as to how investment should be done in this country, and what kind of investments we are actually attracting to this country, and so forth.
On that note, we'll take a short break. On the other side of this break, we'll be rejoined by Dr. W. A. Vijayawardena, former Deputy Governor of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka. Welcome back to Biz First, In Focus. Our guest this evening is Dr. W. A. Vijayawardena, author, former central banker, and here to share some thoughts, including details of his new book, which will be launched shortly, entitled Central Banking, Challenges and Prospects. Dr. Vijayawardena, we'll come back to your book in a minute, but before that, I want to ask you, what's happened has happened, and the paper has been full of it this morning. We know that on Friday, the evidence given by some people created an absolute storm, and it's not really a storm in a teacup anymore. It's much more than that. It's almost tsunami-like. But what positive steps can we take? What are the lessons that we can learn from it this far?
For us now, if somebody who had gone through very closely the history of the bond scam in this country, you would have observed that on the very first day when it took place on 27th of February 2015, the whole market was agitated because there was this one particular bond issue where half of that bond issue had been taken by a single primary dealer, not at his own money, but at the money belonging to the one of the state banks, the Bank of Ceylon.
Mm-hmm.
If the government had taken correct action at that time to nip it in the bud, all these things that has happened so far wouldn't have taken place for us. Unfortunately for Sri Lanka, and unfortunately for the government, and unfortunately for the Central Bank of Sri Lanka, the government didn't take any action, but instead government tried to cover it up. And they could not, however, silence the civil society activists, media, and also they could not silence the people of this country.
Mm.
So the matter was raised again and again, and when it was raised, it every subsequent round, it was actually for us a bigger and more dangerous, more prominent one. So now we have come to a stage where the things that had been revealed before the board commission, it's very difficult for the country to unravel it now, because all those people who are involved in the bond scandal will have to be dealt with severely in terms of the law today. So that's what the country can do today.
And that's probably the best.
That's the best, and that's the only choice available for us, because if you take action today, it will not only set an example for future central bankers, future rulers of this country, that people of this country cannot be silenced. And they do not simply take all these measures adopted by the government passively. So this is a very important message which has been delivered by the actions that has taken so far in this particular regard.
You spent how long at the Central Bank?
I joined the Central Bank in 1973 and I retired in 2009. So probably about 36 years.
About 36 years.
Yeah.
You've written this book.
I have, yes. In fact, it contains a large number of articles I have written over the last maybe 10-year period.
Mm.
Some of the articles had been published in the Central Bank's publications, and they have been updated and brought into the book.
Yeah.
And the other articles had been published since around year 2010, after my retirement. And the objective has been to demystify the working of the central bank, because for anyone outside the central bank, as well as those inside the central bank, central banking has been a mystery.
Mm.
And people have various misconceptions that it is the central bank which should govern the economy, which is wrong. So I had just given the correct principles
right. That
central bank should follow and so forth.
What's the purpose of the book? Is it to give some insight into the operation of the bank?
No, actually, well, this is to educate the public as to what the central bank is, and also educate the people inside the central bank how they should behave, because the topics that I covered for us, they are concerned about the governance structure within the central bank,
mm-hmm.
and the qualifications and the responsibilities of the members of the monetary board of the central bank, the rights, duties and responsibilities of the governor of the central bank, the type of policy that they have to adopt, and the independence that they have to maintain, because a central bank has been created in this society for us,
yeah.
by us, not by the politicians, in order to protect the value of the money that we are holding. And for that purpose, they have to function as an independent body. And what I have actually analyzed in my book is the way that the Monetary Board should protect the money that the central bank has issued and we are holding as our assets. For that purpose, the central bank is simply a trust, and the board members are trustees. So they have to look after our interest rather than looking after the interest of the politicians who have appointed the board members. So this is what I have, the message that I have given in the book.
And these measures, things will improve now?
No, for us, because what has actually happened is that we have got new leadership in the central bank in whom we can now place our trust, because the governor who had been appointed to that position 1 year ago has been functioning as an independent person, and the whole society can trust him. But what I have actually explained in the book is, argued in the book is, for us, we cannot depend on people. We have to depend on the systems. So when it comes to systems, I have suggested there should be lots of improvements when it comes to appointing the governor, and also when it comes to selecting the board members also. Now, for example, in terms of the present law, the appointment of the governor is solely vested with the President of the Republic on the advice of the Minister of Finance, which means for us they can pick up anyone from the street tomorrow and appoint him as the governor of the central bank. But in the best practice in other countries, for us there's a process. There's a well-established process, and the process starts at least 2 years before the incumbent governor retires from his post. For example, now take a country like, say, Bank of Canada or even Bank of England. If the governor is to retire in 2 years hence, they start looking for a person right now. They appoint a selection committee. The selection committees will receive nominations from various parties, and then all these candidates are screened very thoroughly in not only one interview, it's a round of interviews. And finally, 1 year before the incumbent governor retires, three names are suggested to the appointing authority to select one person. Then the appointing authority immediately selects somebody and then makes the announcement that after 1 year, it is this person who will become the governor of the central bank. So that he has time to learn about central banking, he has time to get himself adjusted, and so forth. Now, in the case of Central Bank of Sri Lanka, what we have is, now you would have noted even the appointment of the present governor, Dr. Indrajit Kumaraswamy. It was done 3 days after the incumbent governor retired. Incumbent governor retired on the 30th of June, but Dr. Kumaraswamy was appointed 3rd of July, 3 days after, and during that particular period, the country was totally in suspense. Now, even a country like, say, India, the neighboring country, when Dr. Raghuram Rajan retired from his position, the new governor was appointed 2 weeks before the due date of the retirement. And for the appointment, it has now been reported that the Prime Minister Modi and various other senior people had interviewed a number of candidates, and the interview had gone through throughout the night and selected one person. So these are the improvements that we have to do, because otherwise what would happen is someone might pick up somebody of his choice, maybe someone from the street or someone who had been working somewhere else, and he would be appointed as the governor of the central bank, and he doesn't know the central banking, and he doesn't know how to function, and as a result, the whole country would be driven to a kind of the disaster that we are having, this disorder.
On that note, we'll take a short break. And on the other side of the break, we'll be rejoined by Dr. W.A. Vijayawardene, former Deputy Governor of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka. And welcome back to Biz First, in focus. Now, Dr. Vijayawardene, after 30 years and so on, you've decided you want to put pen to paper. What inspired you to write the book, Central Banking Challenges and Prospects?
The reason for us is, as I mentioned even at the beginning of this discussion, central banking has been a mysterious subject for many people, even those within the central bank. And there are misconceptions, and we have to dig into the first principles of central banking and put them in writing again, so that those who are to join the central bank will know about central banking, and those who are within the central bank can test what they are doing is whether it is central banking, and people outside the central bank, the members of the public, could learn what a central bank is. Mm-hmm. Specifically, the book is addressed to the politicians of the country. They can make use of the book when they want to make judgments. Members of the public, they can know what central bank action and why central bank has taken that action, mm-hmm. and so forth. Those who are inside the central bank can actually reformulate their own plans, strategies, the work behavior, thinking, ideologies, and ethics, and so forth, in terms of the good practices of central banking. Because I have brought into the book all the good practices which are now being followed by central banks throughout the world, and they are being now applied to Central Bank of Sri Lanka.
Why can't we in Sri Lanka get it right at the central bank?
The reason is that because central banking is a subject which has to be learned by everybody. Specifically the people outside the central bank, like the politicians for us, they must recognize and appreciate the role of the central bank of the country. Now, for example, I have given many examples in the past, for us. Now, Dr. N.M. Pereira, who was the Minister of Finance from 1970 to 75, he is considered as a left-oriented politician.
Yeah.
But of course, when it came to central banking, he knew about the central banking, and you know the advice that he gave to central bank people, he addressed them in 1970. He said that he would value any report that would be submitted to him by the central bank which is free from any political color.
Mm-hmm.
Any political color. So he said the job of the central bank is not to praise the political party that is in power. And also the reports that are presented to him objectively and impassionately. Now, that advice coming from a left-oriented politician is not something that we can expect today. So my book has actually, if the politicians read them, they will know how they should behave toward the Central Bank of Sri Lanka, because I have given many examples in the book. Sometimes some ministers of finance finding fault with the central bank management for accommodating an application sent by his son-in-law for a job in the central bank, thinking that the minister would approve it. So that minister had blasted the central bank management, and he got the central bank to immediately withdraw the application submitted by the son-in-law, which had been submitted by son-in-law without his knowledge. So that was the type of ethics and the governance that had been practiced in the past. So what I have brought in this book for us is that the current politician will have to learn from the past. They should know what the central bank is, and also the central bank officers should know how they should operate, and how the politicians should respect the central bank, because if the central bank does its job well, it is the politicians who will become the ultimate beneficiary for us, because they can win the next election. But if the central bank does a lousy job, the first victim of the lousy job is the politician himself.
Does it also deal with this most contentious matter?
Well, of course, I have not touched here in that way, but of course, when it comes to communication, and when it comes to maintain transparency, and I have given the principles here. For example, in one of the articles which I have written immediately after the bond scandal of 27th February, the article was published in 10th of March of the same year, and I have compared that the bomb blast in front of the central bank with the bond blast that took place on the 27th of February. And I have said the bond blast has done more damage to central bank than the bomb blast that took place in 1996 in front of the central bank building, in terms of the loss of the credibility of the central bank. And I have given principles here central bank had been very lousy in the communication. They have just suppressed information.
Mm-hmm.
They tried tooth and nail the action, to justify the action that they have taken,
mm-hmm.
which was completely wrong. And the central bank was to be destroyed by the LTT by exploding a bomb in front of the central bank building.
Mm-hmm.
But that bomb didn't do that much of a damage because the central bank management at that time actually followed good principles of communication. They came before the public. I was present there and I was part of that particular program. So likewise, for us, the people inside the central bank will have to learn what to communicate,
mm-hmm.
how to communicate, and also at what time to communicate, and in what language they have to communicate. And these things have been presented in this book as principles to be followed by
mm-hmm.
the current as well as future central bankers.
And the book is available or will be available soon?
Yes, it will be launched on the 29th of March,
mm.
and it's available for sale immediately after that, and anybody can buy it from us.
Dr. W. Vijayawardhan, thank you very much for being on In Focus, this first In Focus. It's wonderful to have you on our network. We wish you very well with these publications, and we trust that you will carry on the good work in educating and making it simple for the ordinary public to understand what could and has been presented as rather a complicated matter. Thank you very much.
You are welcome, Faraz.
And that's about it from Biz First In Focus. Take care. Good night.